Hi, my name is Renee Glatman. It's my pleasure to introduce you to my new book, Plans for Sentences. Plans for Sentences is a book that looks deeply at the relationship between drawing and writing, not only in how each informs the other in terms of shape and energy, but also in how they work in tandem to build spaces for living and articulation. I'm going to share my screen so that you can see some of the drawings. So the book is composed of 60 drawings and 60 figures. And I think one way of approaching the book is to see the drawings as plans, proposals for future space and thought, and the figures as interpretations, reference points, and lists of materials for those drawings. This one is figure 15. The drawing for figure 15. These electricities will not fail in this orchestration. These electricities will fail and spire in paragraphs of self-intersection. They will spire. They will net and scaffold and will out quietly, a seabird alighting. These sentences will sonar the sea while the land mosses. They will blur where they blacken and will rise interiorly. They will out and reel and over with conduction. They will rise and thin and out. These sentences will open at a slope in a cartography of grain and wire. Something will be said that is not exactly complete and it will curve, will up, will be a monument for this page. Figure 30. These thinning structures will be blowing in high winds for as long as this chapter exists, which will be always. They will tendril in loose piles and be like portals through the substrate. They will rise as they thin. Figure 37. These sentences will take the line of the smear without smearing. Will fall below the fault of the page. They will grain and cluster, independent and complete of the horizon. These places will not always be where they are and will not always remain intact, and only will be measured at the points where they erase themselves and by the thrum of their evacuation. These places will tendril when everyone is sleeping and will lay down wallless paragraphs that are legible only when unseen. These sentences will have climbed the helical field, been a scaffolding of filaments, elaborations on thinning and thinning air, airless atmosphere, all air. Figure 42. These sites will be your monuments in cloud-heavy paragraphs. They will blacken and be your underground. They will curve and thin and will on after closing. They will fail in twilight. These will exist without walls but will have domes, then fog. They will be wallless, curved enclosures for voice, closets for loss, graining for the collective. They will open and climb and swoop diaphanously. Figure 52. These places will open as domes in an immediate and continuous state of becoming something other. Domes to spire, domes to fog, domes failing. These places will be held in the wild thinning of the afterward. They will blacken and be a scaffold. They will fold and thin and be set to motion. They will fail and thin and hollow. They will hold. These sentences will work the ground of the dreaming chapter into a commotion of waking, the ground waking inside the dream, the chapter waking inside a moving torque of hills. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Dara Barwa Dixon. And I'm going to read to you the first poem from the book Tolstoy Killed Anna Karenina, which is coming out on April 5th, 2022. If you were lucky, the same person will fall in love with you over and over and over again. If you were lucky, if your luck calls out over and over, the same one will fall out of love with you in order to fall back in. It's an excruciating process. Nonetheless, it is necessary. You will need to be prepared to recognize someone's love for you, as well as be prepared to follow it as it wanes and waxes. Unfortunately, this means you will need to endure long stretches without love. And these you will need to endure with patience and grace in order to be prepared for love when it comes and love when it disappears. With the strength you've gained, because you've read poems and novels and stories, and you've watched animals and lived with them, and you've loved them, and you've looked at pictures. And by virtue of all these things, you've practiced feeling something as complicating as love without end, and as complicating as love no more. You will have kept up in practice, and you will be able to take what love throws your way, because stories and poems have wrung your heart and shattered your brain over and over again to watch you change. So now you're ready. So when Wednesdays that will never end come, and the necessary days without nights, try not to think about them. They will destroy you. The bright days with no love, the short days without end. For those days, be glad, as patient as a glacier or one big starving panther waiting for its prey. Every time love comes, you will stand there and stand it, or it will come again no more. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Last night, beside the menstrual shadow of the corpse, I saw my mother's legs, her enormous legs opening and closing in a voluptuous trance, sweeping the thick current. The amorous pity of her legs, which, with my mouth, I imitated, still pregnant, or became, by way of imitation, innumerable in the meantime. Her foot, her toe, which refused to dissolve, and which I could still see climbing the transparency of birth, her foot in the piedras continuing to suckle, to insist thickness. Ay, ay, ay. Who is this still mothering with the rags of a mouth, coughing and defecating in the middle of life and continuing to urinate in the occultation of the middle? Snow. And the grave diggers having gone, drifted north in gusts, phalanges nourished by numbers and the supernumerary resemblance of the turnstile. Here it is nighttime in both directions, and in these human temples I attend, I dream, and I carry my grave clothes under my arms, mother. With the cadavers entering childhood still trembling, like sunflowers, I dream. And flushed with humanity, I approached my mouth with the vanity of the dead and dressed like a woman in the path of the coffin's foot in the piedras, living, as it were, no more poorly than any other, with no more blood, sperm, tears, saliva. Fungibility of the mouth. Snow. Dripping from mother, from the window, observing the snowdrift, and her legs, her enormous legs, opening and closing in the thick current, which I, with my mouth, imitated. In the meantime, the corpse's one bare foot, without pedestal, without protection in the ruined street, I, dreaming you, flowing in my body, body of the other, writing myself with an illegibility that leads back to nothing. Don't die as long as I am still alive, or, and tonight, having been born for no reason, it happens, but I am not there. Bear with me. I'm growing less and less precise, it seems, this desire to live, to continue to live, and without demonstration, in a night of infinite reversals between the one and the two, and the afternoon having established its yesterdays. Between our poor day and the great night, at two in the immoral afternoon. The island swam toward me and peeled off its dolphin skin. This legendary business of cracking eggs with a laugh that pinches the anus, the cloaca, the miniature coffins at the point where reality is, except for that rivulet of saliva reflecting the Milky Way, and there, in the dishpan, catch a glimpse of you.
To do is to undo copiously. You live because someone cast enough light onto the edge of the highway, the decomposition of light. You live because you removed yourself from your condition while your family prayed, trapped in the fire, undoing darkness and substance. To do is to undo. You live because the soldiers set their march and their checkpoints above the nest. The soldiers plotted a safe shelter with your blood. To lose one's blood, to lose all of it, to lose one's identity. You live like an animal or like a room ousted from its place, to lose one's place, to lose one's mind, to lose one's address. Because it's precisely this bird leaving the nest, draining the pond, to be callously impoverished, to be transformed, that you embraced as you embraced life.
Hi, I'm Lainey Brown, and I'm so happy to share with you a poem from my new book, Translation of the Lilies, Back into Lists. I started the idea for this book with translating my daily to-do lists into poems. So every poem is a list poem, which contains not tasks, but thoughts surrounding daily occupations. Each poem is titled with a date and numbered, though I don't read the numbers aloud. And the title for the book is inspired by the collection by the wonderful poet C.D. Wright, Translation of the Gospel Back into Tongues. So the poem I'll read for you is titled January 14th, 2016. In considering the form of the list, doing is surrounded by thought. While I began with the notion of translating to-do lists into oblique commentary, I now see dissolved, momentary movements. Tasks which destroy one's substance may be those requiring magnification. Scale means nothing in this respect. A few words placed carefully into a shell, or respectfully on a shelf, or deliberately inserted into blankness can be more costly than a great volume, the contents of an entire bookshelf, or an enormous edifice of tears. Your voluminous collection is currently being housed in a small bird flying without direction. And if the bird should fail? These images are designed to continue as you close your eyes or begin plummeting. What is peril to a bird? First, recline in ink and paper, a series of concentric ribbons, revelations. Quilt a sector of arms, collaborative daughters. Walk through frozen woods, basilisk on your arm, red-hoofed. The only harm you encounter is an imaginary enclosure which prevents the foretold meeting. Rapturously step out of the cavity of this breathing animal. Thank you.